What's up, Northside? How y'all doing this morning? Hey, y'all stand on up. Y'all doing good? Come on, y'all doing good? Y'all, it's church today, and I am so excited to be here worshiping with y'all. Y'all ready to worship? Come on, hey, look to your neighbor and say, man, I'm ready to worship. Look to your neighbor, come on. Hey, we're singing a new song called Praise, and I just love it. It gets your body moving a little bit, but it's all proclaiming the name of Jesus. So, you gotta shake out your arms a little bit, shake. Let's get ready to worship. Y'all ready? Come on.
I'll praise in the valley. I'll praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm short. I'll praise when I'm down. I'll praise when I'm hungry. I'll praise when surrounded. Whose praise is the water, my enemies drown. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise. I know you're still in control. Yes, I will. My praise is a weapon. It's more than a sound. My praise is a shout that brings Jericho down. Faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you. I'll praise cause you're sovereign, praise cause you're red, praise cause you rose and defeated the grave. I'll praise cause you're faithful, praise cause you're true, praise cause there's nobody greater than you.
Stuff. Hey, y'all can grab a seat. Well, good morning. It's Spring Forward Sunday morning. Just to be honest, any of y'all normally maybe you were supposed to come to the 9, but you Spring Forward, you came to the 10:30, buddy? Okay, I see you back there, Joel. I see you, buddy. How many of you guys, like, you are like diehard Spring Forward people? Just raise your hand. You're diehard Spring Forward people, okay? All right, so Mark, you also like losing sleep? Okay, all right. How many are fallback people like me? You gotta love fallback. And then it gets dark at 2 o'clock in the afternoon. It's a whole thing. It's a whole thing. Man, thank y'all so much for being here at Northside Church. Man, if you've showed up today and you're visiting our faith family, we're just honored that you would come. And we believe that you don't just show up here at church haphazardly, but the creator of the universe like brought you here, and we're just honored that you're coming to worship with us today. If you are visiting, we've got a little Get Connected card and the seat back in front of you. You can grab that, fill that out, information about yourself. Whatever you want to tell us about yourself is great. Any way that we can serve you, we'd love to be able to do that. So after the service, you can take that out to the visitor center in the lobby. We've got a gift in exchange for you. Following this week, we'll just drop you a text message, put the ball in your court. So please do that. We'd love to get connected with you. Hey, I just want to introduce a special guest, someone I love so much, and it's my sister, Sarah Milligan. Sarah, can you stand up real quick? I didn't tell you I was going to do this. This is my sister Sarah. She's awesome. Love you. God has done an unbelievable work in her life, and so thankful for the good news of the gospel. We just love Jesus. This is what Jesus does. He takes broken people like us, sinners, and he makes us new, and that's what our church really is all about. Hey, I want to just kind of give you a heads up kind of where we're going as a faith family this month, with Easter weekend is right around the corner, which is, that's crazy, isn't it? We're already talking about Easter. It's a whole thing. Some of y'all still have Christmas lights up. It's weird. So Chris, let me talk about Easter, kind of what we're going on that weekend. We're going to be starting off with a Good Friday service at 7 p.m. that Friday before Easter here in the auditorium. It'll be a great time of worship and reflection on the life, the death, and the burial of Jesus. And so we're going to be talking about that. Much more somber service as we prepare for Easter Sunday. Now, on Sunday morning, we will have three different services. We'll have one at 7:30, sunrise service, no kids side, and then identical services at 9 and also at 10:30, which for those two services, we will have kids side 0 through 3 years of age. We'll also have kids side activity bags for the kiddos and any dads that fidget. And so we'll have some great stuff to keep everybody dialed in. It's going to be a great Sunday. Here's what we need from you. We are going to have, who knows what God wants to do on Easter? It's going to be incredible. But our church has grown so much over the course of this past year, and we really want to try to make room in the 9 and the 10:30 service for people that are visiting, checking out Northside. So if any of you want to be like real missionaries for Jesus and go to the 7:30, man, we would love to see about 200 to 300 people come to the 7:30 service. That would be super, super helpful. So we need everyone, if you can, you can go to our website, you can get the bulletin, you can scan the QR code, go to gonorthside.com/events and register you and your friends and family for one of those services. It would be awesome. On your way out of the auditorium today, our Connect team is going to be at the doors, and they're going to have one of these Easter invite cards. As a faith family, like, we're all about inviting people to surrender. We're all about sharing our lives with one another, and we also want to live sent in the power of the Holy Spirit. And so this is a very simple way that you can live sent. So we gather and then we scatter to the various different places where we live, work, and play. And we want you to think of someone that you can invite to be a part of one of those services. So grab that. Don't throw it away. Don't throw it away. Take it. Give it to someone. God can use you to reach someone with the good news of the gospel. Hey, this time I want to invite our team that's going to be going to Puerto Rico. We're going to be sending a team to Puerto Rico. You guys already got a round of applause. Come on up here. Y'all join me on the stage if you would. So we're sending a team to Puerto Rico this coming Saturday, and we're going to learn a little bit more about the trip, ways that we can be praying for them, learning about their preparation for the trip. And so they'll leave this Saturday through the following Friday. So April, I think you're going to grab a mic, and I'd love it if you can, April, if you can tell us like who we are going to be partnering with as a church for this Puerto Rico mission trip.
Yeah, awesome. Sorry, I don't know why I thought this was at the end of the service, so I'm so glad I walked in here.
No, it's great. It's okay. All is well. All is well.
I misread the text. I love it. So we partner with two organizations, Send Relief and Send Network. Send Relief is a relief organization. They're usually first on the ground, like the Red Cross, when there's a natural disaster. And so because Puerto Rico has experienced a number of natural disasters, they have continued to work there. And so we partner with them. And Send Network, who is the church planting arm. And so we're going to work with on a relief project with a church planter who is already there. And he'll be with us when we're in country, and then he will follow up with the people that we're working with.
I love it. It's fantastic. And you guys are good-looking crew, man. It's awesome. I appreciate you bringing out the vest for today. The vest looks amazing, Chris. Thank you so much. Hey, can you talk a little bit about, April, because sometimes people are like, oh, I signed up for a trip, I paid, and then you go. But y'all have done tons of preparation leading up to this trip. Can you talk a little bit about what that preparation has looked like?
Yeah, absolutely. So like Micah said, it's not you pay and you get on a plane and we go have an awesome experience. We see when someone signs up for a mission trip, it's really a discipleship opportunity to talk about how do we live on mission now? How do we live on mission when we're in country? And how do we do that when we get home? And so our focus has really been, how do we see people? How do we slow down? We listen to the things that they're saying. A lot of people have experienced a pretty significant amount of trauma. And so as they talk and we listen, we can give hope. And so we can give hope by celebrating with them, by praying with them in the moment, by sharing a story from God's word or sharing the gospel. And so this team has put in hours of learning how to do those things.
Hey, we're super proud of you guys taking off time from work and all the things and investing in the kingdom of God. We couldn't be more proud of y'all as you guys go. So there are those that participate and they leave and they go and all the things, but then the rest of us, we're back here. So April, how can we just labor in prayer for the team? Maybe give us some specific ways that we can do that.
Yeah, I think if you could pray for boldness, as we're going to be doing some prayer walking when we're there and we're working at a home in the community, that our team would be bold to be able to share hope, to pray with people and look for opportunities to share the gospel. Another one, we have a significant amount of skills in our group that's here, and so that we would really be able to use those to honor the Lord and just that the Lord would go before us and soften hearts.
That's exactly right. And Gary serves on our team and helps out with a lot of facilities and repairing things. I'm just going to ask you, please don't stay, Gary. Please come back. Because, man, things break and we need you. So just come back. That'd be super helpful. Hey, would you join me? Here's how we'd love to do this. At our church, a lot of times when we have commissionings and things like this, we ask everyone to kind of join in with us as we pray for them by extending an outstretched arm towards this team. So when I pray, if you feel comfortable, would you just raise a hand towards this group and just join me as we pray for these fine folks as they go out on mission. God in heaven, we love you and we are so thankful for this incredible team of just godly men and women who've put their yes on the table to say, yes, we will join you in your mission of seeing people come to know you as Lord and Savior. God, we pray that you would go before them. We pray that you would give them courage. Help them to remember that they don't have a spirit of fear and timidity, but one of courage and a sound mind. We pray that as they go, God, you would take care of loved ones who are back home. And as they go, you would give them safe travels. As they get there on the ground in Puerto Rico, that you would give them all of the grace, all of the strength that they need each and every day to wake up and to take on the attitude and the mindset of Jesus, who did not look to his own interests, but to the interests of others. Help them to serve, to be the hands and feet of Jesus, meeting real physical needs. But we also pray, God, that you would help them to meet spiritual needs through the gospel of Jesus Christ, that they would have opportunities to speak the good news of Jesus and how he lived the life we could not live. He died the death that we deserve to die, but he conquered sin, Satan, death, and the grave through his resurrection. And we pray that people who are in darkness and brokenness because of their sin would be awakened by the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that people's lives would be transformed, where people would get saved, and we'd be sure to give you all the glory and the honor. We love this team. Would you bless them, comfort them, and strengthen them? And we pray, Jesus, that you would be high and lifted up, and would you draw men and women and children to yourself? Jesus, we love you, and we bless your name. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Hey, I'd love it if y'all would stand with us as we continue to sing to Jesus.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of his spirit and washed in his blood, and what he did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Who I trust in God, my Savior.
never fail. And I trust in God, my Savior.
There were like prisons that we couldn't escape, but God, Father. We give you praise in this place. Lord, you are present with us right now. You are in this room. And Lord, I pray that you would accept this offering of praise as we gather. Father, you'd accept this gathering of people who have come together to make much of you. Lord, we cannot hope in ourselves. Cannot hope in our things. Cannot hope in our money. We cannot hope in our control. For, Lord, we can only hope in you. And you're worthy. And you're good. And you've come once. And you're coming again to make all things right. So, Lord, we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You can remain standing. Wild today. All right, I gave you a warning last week. But we're going to try this out. We're going to remain standing out of reverence for the reading of God's word. And we're going to read the entirety of the text that we'll study. And then we'll go verse by verse and have my dear friend Dana, who's going to read for us today.
Thanks. I'm Dana McCall. My family has been here for 8 years. One of our babies was 6 weeks old, and now he's 8. So I always base it off of Baker. I'm reading Matthew 12, 22 to 32. This is the word of God. Then a demon-oppressed man who was blind and mute was brought to him, and he healed him so that the man spoke and saw. And all the people were amazed and said, "Can this be the son of David?" But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "It is only by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, that this man casts out demons." Knowing their thoughts, he said to them, "Every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided against itself will stand. And if Satan casts out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And if I cast out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore, they will be your judges. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Or how can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed he may plunder his house. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. Therefore, I tell you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven people, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. And whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come.
Awesome. Thank you, Dana. You can be seated. Art imitates life. And I think it's fascinating how when media comes out, whether it's musical form or painting, sculpture, on the big screen, you see what the people of a particular culture hold to. You see it in full display to consume. And you see that in the first big blockbuster film that we've seen in 2024 in the Dune series. Some people are big Dune fans. Some people can't sit still for 3 hours long enough to watch a movie once, let alone twice. But the author of the Dune books that became the basis of the movie, Frank Herbert, said this of the movie. He said, "I wrote the Dune series because I had this idea that charismatic leaders ought to come with a warning label on their forehead, may be dangerous to your health." And we've seen that true. You've seen leaders in our culture, political leaders, leaders in athletic endeavors, leaders in business, and unfortunately leaders in the church as well, who are charismatic, who put forward a certain face, but their character can't hold up. And the Dune film, no spoilers, depicts that. So when we think about the leadership of Jesus, it's no wonder why some hold him to be Lord and Savior and worthy of our devotion and worship, while others hate him and misalign him and hurl lies about him or outright reject him. And so as we look to Matthew chapter 12, I want to answer just a couple of simple questions that I hope you'll see. Is Jesus who he says he is? Is Jesus who he says he is? Is he a worthwhile leader? Does his character line up with his competence? And if he is, then what do we do in response to Jesus? So we want to answer those two questions from this fascinating text. And some of the other things that I want you to be able to take with you after having been together in the Word this morning is I want you to understand one of the biggest temptations we run into when we read the Bible. So it's not just that we read the Bible, it's how we read the Bible that matters too. And I want to tell you how not to commit the unforgivable sin. Seems like that would be worth the price of admission, right? That would be pretty important. If there's an unforgivable sin, we want to not commit that. I want you to understand that there's a little bit of a Pharisee in every single one of us. And then finally, and certainly most importantly, I want you to see how fantastic Jesus truly is. And so we have quite an agenda as we turn to Matthew chapter 12 this morning. And so if you have a copy of God's Word, you can turn there. If you like, turn there on a device and track along on a device as well. Take some notes. If you notice in your scripture, we skipped Matthew 12, 15 through 21. That's going to be our primary text that we're going to study on Easter. And so we're passing over that in order to dive right into verse 22. Okay, let's do this together. Then a demon-oppressed man who was blind and mute was brought to him, and he healed him so that the man spoke and saw. Think about the depressing state of this man. So not only can he not see to build relationships with people, to behold the goodness of the world that he lives in, but he also can't speak, and that's especially sad because he's constantly oppressed or possessed by this demon. And what demons do, because Satan is the father of lies and demons follow Satan, they lie. And so no doubt this demon inside of this man was hurling accusations at him. You're trash. You have no value. No one loves you. No one sees you. No one will come to your aid. Your life is hopeless and helpless, and there is nothing you can do about it all morning, all afternoon, and all night long. And so he lives in this state of existence. And then what does Jesus do? Jesus comes to this man, and this man is a complete stranger to Jesus. Jesus has never met him before. His friends bring him there, and they bring him to Jesus, and Jesus heals him because Jesus made time for the broken. Jesus made time for the broken. If you look at the kind of people that Jesus interacted with most in the Gospels, one, it was the bumbling group of disciples that he was raising up who would be the early church leaders to take the gospel to the uttermost parts, and it was people who were broken, people who were lonely, people who were in the shame of sin, people who were sick, people who were blind, people who couldn't walk, people who were paralyzed, people who needed their sins forgiven. Those are the kind of people that Jesus drew near to because Jesus made time for the broken. And he does so, and he heals this man, and then this man sees, and he speaks, and the demon leaves him. And so his friends that brought him to Jesus, they heard his voice for the first time. He heard his own voice for the first time. And for the first time in his life, he was no longer oppressed by this accusing demon that was inside of him. So my sanctified speculation, and take it for what it is that this moment turned from a moment of healing into a moment of celebration. I mean, I could see Jesus giving him a great big hug. I could see them laughing together. I could see the man talking and then being surprised to hear his own voice. I mean, in this moment, there's this moment of celebration because Jesus meets with broken people and he cares for broken people. And there's a crowd around them. And we see in verse 23, all the people were amazed and said, "Can this be the Son of God?" So they're starting to get it. They're starting to believe the things that Jesus had said about himself. And this is what they see. They see that Jesus cares and Jesus is able. Jesus cares and Jesus is able. Wherever you are now in your situation, and it may be one of the big things, and it might be really dark, and you might think, man, I never thought it would be me, and I never thought it would be us, and I never thought it would be this. I want you to know that Jesus cares. And Jesus is able. And Jesus meets with the broken. And he meets with the humble. And he meets with the lowly. And he doesn't set the bar high and ask you to jump and do 100 things before he'll come to you with love. He meets strangers who are humble. He meets strangers who are broken. he meets strangers who humbly come to him. Jesus is who the prophet said he would be. He is who he says he is. Our men on Thursday mornings have a Bible study. We meet dead in the middle of the night at 6:30. It's incredible. There's raccoons out there. There's coyotes, and we're bringing in sausage biscuits, and we're doing that thing. We're opening up God's word to 1 Samuel together, and we're studying. One of the things we've learned together is these types of Christ in the Old Testament. There's these types of Christ, these like symbols that point forward to Jesus that fully fulfills what that type was pointing to. And one of those types would be like Noah's Ark. All the people gathered on the boat. Sin was across the land, and they gathered on that boat. That boat was the only source of salvation for them. And that boat was a type of Christ, because we all bore Jesus in his broken body and shed blood for us. He's our only hope. In our daily discipleship guide Bible study, you read about in Joshua, if you're following along there, cities of refuge. And there's these cities of refuge that were set up in the Old Testament for people that accidentally committed certain types of crimes and did certain things. They would send them off to these cities, these places where criminals and rebels could find a place where they could experience healing and transformation and forgiveness and live in peace. And Jesus is our city of refuge. And you saw David in the Old Testament, this unlikely king who rose, who didn't do everything right, but did some things right. And he walked in the way of the Lord certain times of his life, and he serves as a type pointing us forward to King Jesus, who did get everything right, who was able to shed righteous blood for us on the cross. And so Jesus is that son of David. He's the one who was promised. And that's one of the purposes of the author Matthew in this book, is to get us to understand that Jesus fulfills this lineage all the way back to Adam and through Abraham and David and now to Jesus. That the promise would come true that was made to Eve in the garden, that there would come one someday in her lineage who would crush the head of the serpent. And now he's come, and his name is Jesus. So this Jesus is so caring, he's so gentle, and he's so kind, and he's so powerful. And I want you to take that in contrast to what we read here in verse 24, okay? We're going to contrast that with verse 24. But when the Pharisees heard it, they said, "It is only by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, that this man casts out demons." So before we get into Beelzebul and Bohemian Rhapsody and a whole number of other things that we're going to get into, I just want you to see the tone of the transition here. Like, this miraculous event has occurred. This man can finally see and speak, and he's no longer oppressed by a demon. It's a moment of celebration. It's a moment of peace and joy. It's incredible. And what do the Pharisees have to do? They come up and they just kind of go, "Well, of course he's doing this. You know how he's doing this, right? He's doing this by the power of Satan." Now, where would they get that idea? Where would they get it? Just pull it out of thin air and make up this thing about Jesus to try to undercut his ministry. They're completely removed from any real work of ministry in their life, and they pull this thing out of thin air to try to bury Jesus. What an absolute mess. Now, let's see what happened in here. They say that Jesus healed this man by harnessing the power of Beelzebul. And so you see that name for Satan in other places, Beelzebub. It's another name given to Satan. You remember the lyrics from Queen's Bohemian Rhapsody? Beelzebub, he has a devil put aside for me. For me? All right, it's so much better than the 9 a.m. crowd. So I don't know if you're just listening to a lot more Queen or what's going on here. But this is the first time I've ever mentioned Freddie Mercury, if you know who that is, in a sermon on a Sunday morning. It's the first time. But I read about it, and he wrote that line with this idea that we could live a life so particularly depraved that we would have our own devil put aside for us to torment us for eternity. That was his view of what his life and maybe some others' life would be like as well. And Jesus is saying that he's harnessed the power of Satan in order to cast out a demon. They've taken a good thing and they've twisted it for their own ambitions and for their own vengeance. Man, we have to be so careful that we don't become jaded and hardened to a genuine work of God that we see in our lives. We have to slow down in those moments and just say, thank you, God. You have done this, and I see this, and I give you all the praise and honor and glory for this. God, you give me breath in my lungs. God, you give me a job. You give me a daughter. You give me sons. You give me sons and daughters. You've given me a husband, maybe even a husband that's gone on to be with the Lord. Give me a wife, maybe one that's gone on to be the Lord. Give me these children that I have. Give me this life that I have. Give me this church and these friends that I have. You give me the opportunities that I have. Lord, thank you for this. I was standing just praising the Lord alongside you all. I love to hear your voices and my voice and us joining together praising Jesus, man. And numbers aren't everything, but again, I tell you all the time, I remember when it was like four rows of chairs here, and we're just rubbing sticks together for Jesus, just trying to make it up. And now, man, people are being saved. Marriages are being transformed. The lonely are finding community. Man, God is doing a work, and I recognize that. And I say, thank you, God, for the power of your Spirit shining in and through your people. I am so, so grateful. Look at how blinded these Pharisees are. Their vengeance and their hate and their anger and their bitterness is doing a crazy thing in their heart, a crazy thing in their heart. This quote was floating around just this past couple weeks. The most influential person in your life is the one you've refused to forgive. It's that little voice inside that's constantly speaking, that's constantly telling you, that's constantly bringing up, and you're rehashing and retelling. And if I had one more chance, here's what I would, and again and again and again and again. So the Pharisees were using their own hate and bitterness and vengeance in order to read into who Jesus is. I think the Pharisees make a lot of mistakes. Let's just look at a few of them quickly, okay? Number one is this: they don't actually care about people. They don't care. They don't care that a man who is blind and couldn't speak can now see and speak, and his demon is rid from him. All they care about is their own agenda. Isn't that what hate does? Isn't that what bitterness does? Isn't that what unforgiveness does? We read that into our life, into our situation, every area of our life. Number two, they sit on the sidelines. They don't care that this man is healed. They don't care about the score. They don't care about the good that's done. In fact, they're just sitting on the side, and Jesus' ministry is dragging them along like a boat anchor as he tries to drag Jesus down. And number three, and I want to spend some time on this because I just want to be very careful about this because I think it's a common thing in our hearts, is they do eisegesis. Eisegesis. Eisegesis is not the name of a cryotherapy slash IV place that you can go to. It's not that kind of thing. Eisegesis is this. The word eis means into, and Jesus means lead. So when we do eisegesis, we lead into the text of Scripture when we read our own reality and our own meaning. But exegesis, in contrast, is when we lead out of what the author intended in Scripture as we read, and we allow Scripture to read us and to read our lives. And so putting those two in contrast is this: exegesis, I allow the content to read into my reality. God, your word reads me. You know me. Your word is eternal. And so, Lord, I need your word to penetrate my heart, penetrate my life, and tell me what's true and real and good and beautiful in this world. But eisegesis, in contrast, I allow my reality to read into the content. Preacher Charles Simeon said this in the 18th century: my endeavor is to bring out of Scripture what is there and not to thrust in what I think might be there. And so let me give you an example of eisegesis, and I'll tell you where this is rampant in the world today. Okay, eisegesis is like this. My reality, some would say, God doesn't judge sin. Sin's no big deal. God doesn't have wrath on anyone. There's no judgment. Do what you will. Jesus forgives it. Everything's fine. Who really knows in the end anyway? So when they read John 3:16, for God so loved the world, they would say, look, God loves the world. God loves everyone, loves what it's all about, and that's what we need to go for. But they ignore, like all eisegesis does, the context of Scripture and many other scriptures that say, repent from your sin, pursue holiness in your life. Obedience actually matters. So we can't do eisegesis. We can't read any scripture. One of the areas where this is rampant is like the agenda of sexuality and gender reads into scripture what people want to believe about sexuality and gender. But we have to approach scripture and say, I'm going to read scripture for what it is and what it says, and I'm going to walk according to that truth, allowing scripture to tell me what is true and good and beautiful in this world. Eisegesis is so common in pop culture, in politics, of course, in liberal theology, and we have to be careful because this, eisegesis is not just a mistake. Eisegesis is evil. Eisegesis is evil because we try to use God and his word as a prop for our own personal agenda. I mean, who are we to do that? God's word is eternal. God is eternal. He reads us and tells us what reality really is. So, Jesus responds to the Pharisees. Like, how does Jesus respond? And so, again, it's a good thing that I'm not Jesus, because if I'm Jesus, I heal this man, and now we're celebrating, he's speaking, and he's seeing, and we're just having a great time together. And then if I'm Jesus and you come and tell me, well, the only reason you're able to do that is because Satan gave you the power to do it, I'm like, you're ash. It's just ash right there. And I'm walking, my Reed's text here is like, I'm just kicking the dirt and the ash is floating up in the air as I walk through it and just go out. That's how I'm reading this text. But that's not what Jesus does. That's not what he does. And so this is what it says in verse 25. He says, knowing their thoughts, he said to them, every kingdom divided against itself is laid waste, and no city or house divided against itself will stand. So Jesus knows their thoughts, and Jesus knows your thoughts, and he knows my thoughts as well. And he knows that they're self-righteous, and he knows that self-righteousness is so blinding. Because for the Pharisees, it wasn't a matter of evidence. There's nothing that Jesus could do or say to convince them. There's a quote that says this, the same sun that melts the wax hardens the clay. And so there's different responses that people have to Jesus. And some people respond in faith and humility and in obedience and glad submission to him. And man, other people, it just hardens. And the more Jesus, the harder that heart gets. That's why I have to be so careful. You got to be so careful about a hardening of your heart. Because man, really difficult things happen in the world, and your heart wants to harden. And you see really painful, broken things in the world, and your heart wants to harden. And it's really difficult to follow Jesus. And your heart gets hard, and you don't get your way, and you don't get what you've prayed for. We've got to be so careful to keep our hearts soft before the Lord, man. Keep coming to his word. Allow other people to speak truth into our life. Keep gathering for worship. Keep singing out worship songs, man. Keep praying. Their hearts are hard toward Jesus. And Jesus points to verse 26. And if Satan casts out Satan, he is divided against himself. How then will his kingdom stand? And if I cast out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your sons cast them out? Therefore, they will be your judges. Jesus said, it doesn't make any sense that I would use the power of Satan to cast out Satan. Like, it's your self-righteousness has so blinded you that you make absolutely no sense. It's what self-righteousness actually does. Jesus confirms their nonsensical conclusions. Verse 28, he says, but if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. So he reveals how he was able to heal this man. And it wasn't by harnessing the power of Satan. It was by the power of the Holy Spirit, the same Spirit that now lives in us, healing this man. It's no trick at all. He does this miracle because of the Spirit's work in his life. And the same Spirit that worked then is at work today as well. Verse 29. Or how can someone, I love this verse, enter a strong man's house and plunder? You have a vision of like a big giant guy, like a big strong man. That's what I think about. How can someone enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man? Then indeed may he plunder his house. So Jesus tells them, all right, you're saying that I've done what I've done by the power of Satan. I'm telling you, this is why I've come. I've come that I may bind up Satan, who believes that he is one in this world, who rules over this world. We see that as the evidence of the brokenness in the world all around us. I've come to tie him up and take down his house. Man, that'll preach, won't it? that'll preach. Jesus has come to tie up Satan and to take down his house. That's what Jesus has come to do. So when we look around and we see the clowns that we have running for certain positions in our country, and we're like, man, which one is the better of these clowns? And like, man, we have no hope, but I got to pick one, and I don't know who I'm going to pick. And when we look at our own bodies, and our bodies are like aging and breaking down, you're like, man, this is terrible. I woke up one day tired, and it hasn't stopped. Man, we look around, and like people we really, really love and care about are making decisions that just disappoint us, that hurt us. We're like, man, I wish you would. We know we can't find hope in this world, but Jesus has come, and he's tied up Satan, and he's taking down his house. And he's the one that we put all of our hope and trust in because he cares and he is able. Verse 30, Jesus says, whoever's not with me is against me. Whoever's not gather with me scatters. So Jesus knows these Pharisees are dead set on not believing him. Jesus knows there's no careful, creative way that he can put his words. He knows he can't be winsome enough. He knows he can't be just kind enough in the moment. He knows that they are dead set on not believing because their hearts are too hardened. We see this in contrast to the faith of the centurion soldier that we studied in Matthew chapter 8. I think it's fascinating to think, same Jesus, but two different responses. Look how this centurion soldier responded to Jesus when he wanted Jesus to heal his servant at his house. It says, but the centurion replied, Lord, I'm not worthy to have you come under my roof, but only say the word and my servant will be healed. This isn't making up an agenda and reading into Jesus. It isn't trying to trap Jesus. It isn't trying to use Jesus for his own agenda. He's saying, look, I don't even deserve to have you anywhere near me. I'm a sinner. I have shame. I'm broken. But if you say the word, man, I'm coming. I'm coming. That's different. That's faith. That's humility. That's the kind of thing that Jesus loves. Because in verse 10, he says this. He says, truly I tell you, with no one in Israel have I found such faith. Man, this is what it looks like. Not great performances for Jesus. Not lots of flash for Jesus. But faith for Jesus. And then Jesus turns to this unforgivable sin thing. Let's read about it, talk about it, and then we'll conclude our time together. Therefore, I tell you, every sin and blasphemy will be forgiven people, but the blasphemy against the Spirit will not be forgiven. And whoever speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but whoever speaks against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven, either in this age or in the age to come. All right? So people read this particular text, and here's what some people think. Okay, I'm going along in my life, and I'm making these decisions, and I'm making these steps, but somewhere around here, there's an unforgivable sin that I might commit. And so if you just tell me what that unforgivable sin is so I can just not step there as I'm going about my days, then that would be great because I want to be forgiven by Jesus. That's not exactly in the whole context of what we're reading here. Jesus is saying, look, if your heart is so hard, then when you look at me and the beautiful work that I'm doing, if you have nothing else to say other than he's probably doing that by the power of Satan, I'm going to go out on a limb and say you're probably not a Christian. Because Jesus softens hearts through conviction of the Spirit and brings people to a place of faith and surrender where they would never, ever, ever say something like this. And so if you're asking the question, man, I don't want to do something that's not going to be forgiven. I want to tread lightly before Jesus because I know wherever he goes is holy ground and I'm a sinner and I don't deserve to be in his presence. But if he's saying the word, I'm coming and I want to be healed, then that's the type of mentality that would never commit any type of unforgivable sin like what Jesus is talking about right here. So the two questions we said we were definitely going to answer by the end. Number one is this, is Jesus who he says he is? I would say the answer is absolutely. Absolutely. He's the Son of David. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Man. He's our representative who obeyed perfectly on our behalf so that he could shed righteous blood and have his body broken for us. We can put our faith and trust in him and we can be saved. He is who he says he is. He has done all that he's promised he'll do and he will do everything he's promised to do. And then what do? We bow and worship and we walk in glad obedience. thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. Now, Jesus, show me the way. Show me what my yes needs to be. Show me what my no needs to be. Show me what the first hour of my day needs to look like. Show me what the final 3 hours of my night need to be like. Show me what I need to put off. Show me what I need to put on. Show me the way that I should go in my life. And in walking in that way, I found hope, I found truth, I found joy, I found beauty, just like the blind, mute, and demon-oppressed man did. Let's pray together. Father, we collectively cry out that your grace is enough for us. That Father, even though we are changing, even though we might have had a good morning, but then we have a bad afternoon and a bad night, might have had a bad day or a bad week, might be a bad year. Jesus, you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. You are immutable. You do not change. So Lord, help us not to have our hearts hardened. Help us not to run from your truth, but to it. Father, help us to recognize the beautiful things that your Spirit has done and is doing. Lord, so we could hope in you. Jesus, even your name, God Saves, shows us that there is hope. So Jesus, our hope is in you, our trust is in you, our life is found only in you. We love you in Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand and sing in praise to Jesus.
Our Lord God is amazing, isn't he? He's the same yesterday and today. Sing this with us.
Lift your head, lift your eyes. Look to the sun. In the test, in the trial, his grace is enough. His grace is enough. And oh, my soul, remember who you're singing to. Take heart, hold on. Remember who you're singing to. He's still the Lord Almighty. He's still the King of Kings. He's still the risen Savior, reigning over everything. His name is still the highest. His strength will never fail. Take heart, hold on.
Northside, sing.
Remember who you're singing to. He's still the Lord Almighty. He's still the King of Kings. He's still the risen Savior, reigning over everything. His name is still the highest. His strength will never fail. His word is ever. The one thing I'm sure of.
Family, I'm so thankful for you. It is a absolute joy to get to serve as one of your pastors. I'm so just amazed at God's goodness, and you are evidence of that to me. I look around the room, see so many faces and friends and sweet, dear people to me in my life. And I can't believe that I and we get to do this together. So thankful for you. If you want to exercise generosity in giving through Northside Church as a part of your worship, you can do that. There's some giving boxes you can give on the way out. If you'd like to set those things up online, you can do recurring giving. That's super helpful for our own planning purposes. You can do those things. If you want to give creatively through stock and other ways, we can be more than glad to talk to you about that and giving to our general fund. Are giving toward our movement fund as well. Thursday morning, our men's Bible study. It's the last one. We'll have like a teaching environment, and then we'll dive into discipleship groups after that. And so if you haven't been a part of that with us, I invite you to join us on Thursday morning. It'll be a great time together. We'll have breakfast brisket tacos. And so it'll be the day of the nap. It'll be awesome, that all that afternoon. You'll be so productive. Not really, but it'll be a great time together that morning. It's been so sweet to gather with that room full of guys lifting up Jesus and studying who Jesus is and praying and crying out to God on behalf of ourselves and our families to Jesus. So it's really cool. Our last thing we do is we read scripture together as a part of our service. Our reading comes from Romans chapter 8. We'll read this loudly and carefully together. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. Let's continue on in the faith this week. You are dismissed.